Welcome, Tech It Up with Jessica Lee. I'm here with Jesse Osborne, who is head of sales development at Tipulti. Hi, Jesse. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me today.
Tipulti is providing this finance platform for onboarding a ton of contract or the gig economy people, right?
Yep.
I think this is very exciting what you're doing. Tell us more about how that helps companies that has a lot of contracts.
Yeah. Well, as you mentioned, with the advent of the gig economy, the traditional accounts payable structure, that model, has been completely flipped upside down, right? So you go back in time, companies would, they'd bring on new vendors, contractors, suppliers, and how does that work? They send you an invoice, and then your accounts payable department has to process it and reconcile that in the accounting system and remit the payment. But with the gig economy, that kind of got flipped upside down, right? I think about my example I love to give is Uber. I think they have 2 million drivers and do 15 million rides a day.
Yes.
That would be take a massive army of accounts payable department people to pay 15,000 invoices or 15 million invoices a day, right?
Well, you got to automate all that.
You have to automate it, right? So that's how Tipulti was started.
Okay.
And then as we grew and brought on more clients, then we found that they were also have these hybrid use cases where they were getting a lot of invoices sent to them and asked us to start building out our product to help structure that so they didn't have to have their accounts payable people bringing on new vendors and reconciling with the accounting system and remitting payment. It all works the same. So we started to grow our business, and now we've got those are sort of the two areas that we really help companies with.
So you have about 300 employees, companies
right now, yep.
Fast growing. You're hiring a ton of people.
Like crazy, yep.
And your platform actually works with the ERP systems.
Yep.
So it's just an additional part of the finance stack, right?
Massive, massive piece, right? Yeah. Because when you think about all these invoices that come in not with the gig economy stuff, because that's usually in a dashboard. They're not sending an invoice, right?
Mm-hmm.
But with the companies that have a high volume of invoices, those have to typically get emailed in, and then they need a way to approve those. So that's what I love about Tipulti. I get invoices and I just click a button, approve. And magically, it gets reconciled in the accounting software, and that vendor gets paid.
Okay.
And I don't have to get the calls from, hey, I sent you an invoice. Where's that payment, right?
And you are in charge of sales development.
Correct, yes.
So, like inside sales.
Yep.
Generating opportunities.
Yep.
So, talk to us about, say, the methodology, because mm-hmm. you've come into this company and set up a lot of discipline and processes, the culture to see higher performance.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to hear about what you share with me is the situational leadership. Tell me about that.
Yeah. Well, I think it starts with the hiring profile, right? So I've come across a lot of folks that say, hey, I know this person in college or they played sports and they're really energetic. I think they should go in sales, but they don't have closing experience. So let's get them as an SDR. And I like to go a little bit deeper than that. So the hiring profile, I think you have to think about the product that you're selling, the problem that you're solving. And is that person, do they have some exposure to that, right? So in our world, I look for folks that have experience, some type of experience with accounting. They don't have to be an accountant,
mm-hmm.
But we did have an SDR that was a former CPA, right? So when you talk about that learning curve that they have to go through to be able to digest everything, they have to learn a new industry, new acronyms, and then they have to learn all the new tools of an SDR. And they have to, it can be intimidating, right? You're just getting out of college and now you're talking to someone with a CFO title and that's a little scary, right?
Yes.
So I think trying to enable that at the hiring front. But then what you're talking about is, that early stage in someone's career, right? Especially at that first job. I've worked at a couple different companies where the hiring plan is get them in and park them next to that person and they'll show you the ropes, right? Hit your quota.
Right.
And that can be a hard thing to digest.
It's a lot of pressure.
It's a lot of pressure, right? And if you only measure success based on that quota ability, especially for a new hire, is that really what you want them to do is hit that quota or you want them to get ramped up? So I know in SaaS, we go really fast and it's like there's no time. We don't have time for two-week training sessions and classrooms, right? We got to jump in and go. But I think trying to build that bridge and take that approach of providing the structure to where they're not going to have to walk in and just figure things out on their own, but where you can provide that structure on the front end.
Mm-hmm.
So the situational leadership model that I mentioned is what I've coached a lot of my managers to do is think about that first stage of a new job.
Mm-hmm.
You're in the honeymoon phase, right? Boss is cool. Got a cool office. We get free lunch, right? There's no quota my first month, so I'm like, there's no pressure and things are great. My coworkers are great. And they're in that honeymoon stage. But as a manager, you have to direct that person. They need coaching. And we've all made this mistake where you go up to a new hire and say, Jessica, what do you need help with? I don't know what to ask you. I don't know what I need help with. So it's really trying to match what stage that person's in. So when they're in that stage one, that honeymoon phase,
they don't know what they don't know.
They don't know what they don't know. So yeah. You have to provide that direction to them. And then they're going to hit this proverbial stage two that everybody hates, but everybody hits it no matter what company you're with, no matter what job you're in. You're going to hit this after honeymoon. You're going to hit this wall and you're going to start second guessing yourself. You're going to hear somebody say something like, don't you remember we talked about that?
Mm.
Don't you remember we trained on that? Someone's going to second guess you and it's going to put all this doubt in your mind, right? Customer's going to ask you a question that you don't know the answer to. And you're going to go, ooh, am I not picking up on this quick enough?
Right.
And so this doubt starts to creep in.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where you can lose people. And so as a manager, it's really recognizing that. My favorite thing, I tell people this their first day on the job, that hey, you're going to hit that second stage. You're going to hit it. You can't avoid it.
Yes.
You can't. There's no way to bypass it. You're going to hit it. And that's what we're here to do, is help you get through that. And I think that's where you see folks that are new to a job, they have to feel comfortable that they've got someone to talk to. So in that first stage, you got all the structure, right? Here's your to-do list. Here's your tangible action items. Then you're going to hit the wall and I'm here to help you out. And then folks get to the next stage and there might be a little, I call it the complacent stage where you know the job, you know the motions, you know how to hit your numbers and all that stuff. You know the tools, but you're not really going on all cylinders. You're not crushing your quotas. And these folks get lost in the shuffle, right? They're what a lot of companies refer to as like my B players. Mm. That's what I hear a lot is, got to give all the training attention to the new person because they need training. And then you got your quota crushers who are like that fourth stage that are just blowing their numbers out of the water. It's those people in between that often get lost in the shuffle. And I've heard your leaders say all the time, well, if they want to be part of the A team, they better crush their numbers. But there's a management responsibility there, right? There's a responsibility. And I think of that as inspiration.
Mm.
And I tell people, I can't motivate you. You got to have motivation. I can inspire you though. So got to have something that's motivating you yourself. Maybe it's if you have a family, maybe it's your kids, right? Maybe you want to buy a golf course someday. I don't know. Like I need to save $10 million to have a piece of it or something, right? So you have to have something that you're chasing. And that's our job as leaders to remind them of that.
Mm.
And then once they get to that fourth stage, they're off and running. Not directing that group. You're asking them how you can help. That's where you ask, what can I do for you?
I like how you lay out the different stages so that there's anticipation.
Yep.
And they feel the trust. Mm-hmm. Like you've got a roadmap. You're experienced enough to know. And that when they actually hit that, say, stage two, hitting that wall, they're comfortable enough to say, yeah, I've hit that wall now. I need help.
Raise your hand, right? Yeah. You're going to hit it. And I think in my experience, I've hired, I try to add it up just based on the companies I've worked for and how many teams I've had. And I've had somewhere close to around 300 people that have either reported directly to me or a manager that has reported to me. And I see it, I can't think of one person that didn't hit that wall. Everybody wants to go honeymoon stage to like quota crushing.
Yeah.
But you might be able to skip that third one, right? But that second one, you're going to hit it. And that's when the recruiters start calling you. Hey, we got this cool company over here, and you miss the honeymoon stage. You miss that good feeling, and that's when you see a few months on someone's resume. A lot of times, that's what it is. And
I know there's a lot of turnover in this SDR profession because it's hard. It's one of the hardest jobs in the organization. But you've managed to keep that turnover very low.
I have, yeah.
Right? I mean, and how do you do that? There's a culture aspect. There's a discipline training.
Yep. It starts on day one. Mm-hmm. It starts on day one, and it's making sure that folks know there's a plan. I've worked at several different earlier stage startups, and usually the plan is get them a computer. Oh yeah, forgot. Yeah, we got them a desk. Their keyboard's coming next week. That's not setting them up for success, right? We map out a very detailed plan for your first 2 weeks. I've done this at every company I've been with, right? And I'm talking hour by hour with checklists and milestones and all that stuff. You want that person to feel a sense of accomplishment, right? And shadowing a peer is not a sense of accomplishment, in my opinion. So it's having those checklist things that they can go through. And it's also a little reassuring too, right? To know, hey, there's a plan for me. I've got something to do. if you've ever been new at a company, it's one of the most uncomfortable things, right? What's that guy's name over there again? I forget. There's so much that you're uncomfortable about. And so I think getting ahead of that and making sure they know, hey, we got a plan for this. We're going to make introductions. We're going to get you a buddy who's going to be that person to fill in the blanks. And you got to train the buddy on how to be a buddy, right? You can't just say, this is your buddy. You got to train that buddy. So these are constant iterations over time. I didn't just make this up one night, right? These are phase 1, 2. I'm on phase 572 now. Right?
And you have a career plan for them so they understand.
So important. So important.
What's next, right?
Yeah. I think nobody wants to get stuck in that rut, right? And SDR is a challenging leadership position because I haven't met an SDR that said, you know, don't promote me for like 2.5 years because I really want to, I want to be set up for success. Who said that? That's what we say to them. We say, yeah, you're going to be an SDR for, you know, at our company, we say 1.5 years, right? Maybe 1 year, maybe 2 years, but like, it's not going to be in 6 months, right? We want to set you up for success. And a lot of times that we say that and we feel good, like we message it correctly. How is that message received? Right. If you don't know what I'm capable of, right? Why do I have to get lumped in with this everybody else, right? What if I crush it? And so I think it's creating that structure, that conversation, that relationship with them where they feel comfortable voicing that and makes you as a manager more comfortable voicing it and being open with them.
Tell us about the results. You're just seeing a ton of opportunities in the pipeline now because of this disciplined approach.
Yeah.
And nurturing approach.
Yeah, I know it's driven a few folks. It's made a few head scratches, and not to toot. I'm not going to take all the credit. This is me putting some of this in place, but it's the people doing it, right?
Yes.
I looked at my first year at Tipalti. I looked at Q4. I looked at October, November, December, and I looked in Salesforce, and I saw the proverbial seasonality. Okay, October is going to be our best month. November is going to be okay. December. Might as well take an early vacation,
yes.
Right? That's what the history told me.
Yes.
And that was the same thing for the year before that too. So no one was expecting what they saw. Not only did we have our best month ever in that October, we beat that in November. And December, we beat November.
Wow. So it went up instead of down.
Yeah. So really messed up the quotas for this year, right? but to me, it wasn't a campaign. We implemented this new tool. Oh, we changed the subject line. Oh, we made SDRs make more calls. It wasn't a tactical thing. It was making sure we didn't have people leaving. And it's as simple as that, right? And I know all the pressure, I think, that a lot of folks in a position where you're reporting to someone who's very senior, maybe a CEO, they may not – they want to know what's ROI. Like how long will it take for an SDR to hit full quota? And if they don't, what do? Get rid of them? And you got to push back on some of that. Sometimes they're right. Sometimes they're wrong. But can't be that black and white, right? And maybe the quotas weren't right, right? Now, who wants to say that? Who wants to say, hey, I set your quota, but I'm sorry, Jessica, I set it too high. We'll get it next time, right? Like, but it's a two-way street. And so as a leader, you got to be insanely data-driven to really make sure that you're setting people up for the right targets, then giving them the training to get there, and then being able to spot any trends that they could – that you can articulate up to say, hey, we might not hit our quota this month. Or, hey, I think we're going to blow it up this month. So, we missed our quota in August, but twice fold made up for that in October, right?
Yeah.
Made up for that again in November. And by the end of the year, we created more opportunities than we were expected to this year or last year. And that was because, in my opinion, we didn't have this constant turnover. Folks, the more people you have in month 2 versus month 3, if you've got a bunch of people in month 7, 8, 9, 10, they're up and running. They're going. If you have a crew like that, they're going to start. They're not going to be as clunky or inefficient.
Yeah, it's a tight job market.
Yeah.
So being able to recruit and retain is so important.
Yeah.
And you're doing a fantastic job on that. So what is exciting ahead? You know, is there something that you're going to be pushing, a new initiative or something you're going to try that's different?
Yeah, I mentioned earlier, this is iteration on training number 592, right? Mm. It's never done. Mm. You don't have a finished product. I think the SDR world, if you will, by the time you get someone to that 12 to 18 to 24 mark, they're gone, right? Now you got to bring it in again. So it is Groundhog's Day from that standpoint. And so it's really on leadership to make sure that that you're not slipping, right? Yeah, I trained this group really well, but yeah, the next group, I just said all those words 2 weeks ago, last month, like I'll go a little lighter. And then you kind of give up, right? Because you're tired of repeating yourself. it's got to be consistent with everybody. It's got to be consistent, and that's the engine. And if you keep that retention, it's that to me, that's why I was so passionate about talking about this, is that it's not just about a tool or tactic or anything like that. I mean, those are all important, don't get me wrong, but thinking about that new hire, that experience they have in that first 3 month, that ramp up period, if you want to call it that, really making sure they're set up for success. And hey, you hear it all the time, make sure your people are successful. Let's get into the details of how to do that, right? So that's what I really try to focus on is I know we all want to make people successful, but it's just a buzzword unless you actually do something about it. So that's why I say we get really detailed with that new hire training, that if you don't have a structured plan for them in the first 2 weeks, what do you think they're going to do when they go home, right? Unless they're crushing it out of the gate, they're not going to feel a connection. They're not going to feel like you prepared for them, yet that you're expecting them to deliver, but you're not, right? You're
delivering a partnership. Paycheck, that's it. It's a partnership. Exactly. So you've got 25 folks in the team, and you're looking to hire a lot more.
A lot more. Yeah.
Double this year?
Well, you know, it's we doubled 2 years ago. We doubled last year. And we're doubling again this year.
Wow.
So now doubling as you get bigger is a bigger number, right? So so we're not – I don't always look at just headcount as the way to double, right?
Yeah,
We're constantly trying to improve efficiency, and can we reduce ramp time and all that stuff, right? Those are important things to consider.
Excellent.
But as an organization, on fire, just
excellent.
On fire right now. And just seeing all the new folks that are coming in, and everyone like with a bounce in the step, it's the most lively environment I've ever worked in. So
thank you so much, Jesse, for being on the show and sharing your best
thank
practices.
Thank you for having me. Yeah.
There you have it, folks. Jesse Osborne from Tipulti.